Good morning.
Rescue people from slavery. God can rescue us and will place your trust in God's love. Even though temptations surround us, drawing us away from God.
Thanks, babe. Hey, good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. This is the day the Lord has made, so let us praise him for this transforming journey we're on in this Lenten season. On behalf of our pastor, Mija Cho, we welcome all of you to Oxon Hill United Methodist Church on this first Sunday of March. We're not perfect, but we're a great multicultural family that welcomes everyone to the body of Christ. No matter your race, skin color, national origin, creed, or sexual orientation, we welcome everyone. We're so grateful that you chose to worship with us today. Is there anyone here who is worshiping with us for the first time and would like to introduce him or herself? No, it looks like we're all family. For those of you joining us on Zoom, if it is your first time, we ask you to please put your contact information in the Zoom chat field so that we may express our appreciation to you. Please continue to pray for peace and justice in this country and around the world. Specifically, let us pray for the people of Gaza, Ukraine, Sudan, Congo, and other people that find themselves in war-ravaged situations. Sometimes we don't hear about these other countries, but there are several others where there's a lot of turmoil going on as well. Let us also remember our Savior's call to love one another as He first loved us. We're grateful for all our worship participants this morning. And I just want to remind you that just before Lent, we handed out Lenten devotionals that our members had worked on. And donated their time and effort and thoughts about God. And so I pray that you're reading them on a daily basis. I find them so enlightening and encouraging, and I hope that you do as well. As we read those devotions, let us ask God to change our hearts and make us more like Jesus, who is the very epitome of love and justice. Now, let us celebrate and show our appreciation to God for His love, guidance, and protection by enthusiastically joining in worship together this morning. Thank you so much, and have a blessed Sunday.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. I invite you to stand all over the church and join together in singing the great hymn of faith, How Firm a Foundation. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. The scripture declares, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ.
Sign the cross to consume. to receive your healing and your grace. Mighty God, create a clean heart, right spirit within us. Do not turn away from us. Show us your shining faith so that we can experience your grace and your mercy in this time of worship. You always guide us into green pastures and beside the still waters, but we are like a wandering sheep, turned away from you, seeking others. Mighty God, please forgive us. Please forgive us our unfaithfulness. Please forgive us our apathy. Mighty God, please fill us with your Holy Spirit and passion and enthusiasm for your missions and for your kingdom. Give us heart of the joy and praise and hymns and psalms so that we can truly please you through our presence, through our worship. We give you thanks in the last week that you always calling us and watching over us. Thank you for your protections. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace upon our lives. In all circumstances, you taught us to be rejoiced and be thankful and pray without ceasing. This is the will of God. Mighty God, we thank you that you always give us grace. So now this time of worship, we're asking you, your presence empowers, take away all the element, our thought that does not please you, but focus on you, focus on the cross so that we can be truly be blessed and be a blessing with others. Mighty God, we offer special prayers for our world peace, for those who are suffering from war and violence, Ukraine and Russia and Israel, and Palestine and Sudan and Congo. There are so many people who are seeking shelters, coming from some place to have a better place. You know all their situations. So mighty God, please let them see your guidance and your directions so that they can truly see the light in this earthly, temporary life. We offer special prayers, our church and mission ministries and children and young adult and youth ministries. Please send us good workers for your kingdoms, for your missions, so that we can be a light and beacon of light to the community, to those who are wandering, lost their way, so they can find their way and feel your presence. Mighty God, we offer special prayers, our people who are suffering from physical illness and disease, our loved ones in our heart. We name the people you, even though we don't allow to pronounce their name, but they are in our heart. Listen to their cries of pain and bring your healing and restorations, mighty God. We bring our voice and instrument and pianos and the message. Listen to us, Almighty God. And we thank you that you listen our prayers and provide our prayer supplications ahead so that we can truly glorify you and testify your holy name. Now, as children of God, we offer our prayers that your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespasses against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church and family. Today's scripture is from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. That is the Ten Commandments, and I am reading from the Common English Bible Version. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You must have no other gods before me. Do not make an idol for yourself, no form whatsoever, of anything in the sky, above, or on the earth below, or in the waters under the earth. Do not bow down to them or worship them, because I, the Lord your God, am a passionate God. I punish children for their parents' sins, even to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me. But I am loyal and gracious to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. Do not use the Lord your God's name as if we're of no significance. The Lord won't give anyone who uses his name that way. Remember the Sabbath day and treat it as holy. 6 days you may work and do all your tasks, not you, not your sons or daughters, your male or female servants, your animals or the immigrants who is living with you. Because the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and everything that is in them in 6 days, but rested on the Sabbath day. That is why the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that your life will be long on the fertile land and the Lord your God is giving you. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not testify falsely against your neighbor. Do not desire and try to make your neighbor's house. Do not desire and try to take your neighbor's wife, male or female servant, ox, donkey, or anything else that belongs to your neighbor. That is the word of God.
Come on up.
Good morning. I'll have you have a seat here. You can have a seat up here. You can have a seat there, and you can have a seat there, wherever you want to sit on the cushions. Are you aware of what's going on outside? What is it? Spring? Oh, yeah, it's going to be. What are the trees doing? What are the flowers doing? Blooming, yes. They're blooming. Spring and summer brings life. Lenten season also tells us of life. Spring, the summer, but Something we, as God's people, do during the spring and summer, we think of vacations. Vacations, we pack our bags, we pack our suitcases. If we're going for a very long trip, we'll pack a trunk, if you know what a trunk is. If you go to the beach, what do you think you're going to take? Exactly. Very wise woman here. She's going to take sunscreen. What about a bathing suit? How about a beach ball? Yeah. Now, we pack our bags in life when we go on a vacation. It could be a suitcase, a backpack, a trunk, a beach bag, even a push suitcase. We think of our destination in great depth. Great depth. Where do we want to go? How much can we afford? Where do you want to go? Disney? Where do you want to go? See your family? You know, where would you like to go on vacation? To the beach, yeah. And you're going to take your sunscreen, like she said, right? Yes. Now, we think of all these things that we need, that we need, that we want. We don't need everything that we think of. We start thinking about our mode of transportation, how we're going to get there. Car, bus, airplane, walk. We're going to program our GPS. These are all things that we think so much of. And I say they're or the IEIEIs. We're so involved. We're so interested in these things. And we have interest. Intense involvement. Now, when we get somewhere that we're going to go on vacation, where are we going to stay? Hotel, motel? Go camping? What do you sleep in? A cabin, a tent? All these things we think of so intensely, but then we think about what we're going to see. And as Methodists, we're going to think about what we eat. You know, we're Methodists, we love our eating food. But you can't stop at every Methodist church and eat, okay? They're just not having potlucks every day of your vacation. But you may want to take an extra nice dress or suit for that one night that you all go out and you have a nice meal. The point of this is we take more interest in our vacations than we do in the Lenten season. Jesus was also involved, intense, and interested. He was interested in us. He was involved very intensely. He gave his life. Now, Lenten, Jesus said when he gave his life, there would be many rooms in his house. We do not need any baggage when we're with Jesus. All he asks is that we give him our heart. There's no baggage in that, and Jesus accepts us. No baggage, no trunks, no planning with where you're going, because you're with Jesus and your heart's with Jesus. Amen? Amen. Okay. Amen. Thank you. I'll take this. You can take that and give it to the gentleman right there. You want to take that and give it to that gentleman right there.
Good morning, everyone. Please stand for the reading of the Word of God. Aren't you glad to be here today? Yes, amen, amen. I am so glad to see each and every one of you. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible, John 2nd chapter, verses 13 through 22. Jesus in Jerusalem at Passover. It was nearly time for Jewish Passover, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple those who were selling cattle, sheep, and doves, as well as those involved in exchanging currencies sitting there. He made a whip from ropes and chased them out of the temple, including the cattle and the sheep. He scattered the coins and overturned the tables of those who exchanged currency. He said to the dove sellers, "Get these things out of here. Don't make my father's house a place of business." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Passion for your house consumes me." Then the Jewish leaders asked him, "By what authority are you doing these things? What miraculous sign will you show us?" Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up." The Jewish leaders replied, "It took 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But the temple Jesus was talking about was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered what he had said, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of God for the people of God. God bless you.
So can you repeat after me? And you can follow my body prayers. Jesus, Son of God, fill me with your joy. Jesus, Son of God, fill me with gratitude. Jesus, Son of God, speak through me. Empower me so that we can receive your healing and restorations. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. During the Lenten Bible study on Wednesday, Brother Siom asked a very good question regarding the Sabbath day as we discussed about worship. And he said, "Pastor, how do we see to keep Sabbath day to be holy?" So let me ask you, how we keep the Sabbath day to be holy? Right, Sister Vivian said by observing Sabbath and going to the church and to worshiping God. Some people may confuse the terms of a Sabbath. Sister Vivian said it correctly, but let's dive into more deeper information, deeper knowledge of God. The word Sabbath comes from Hebrew, which means the seventh day of the week, and the Day of Atonement. Atonement means repentance. The word holy in Hebrew is kadash, which means dedicate and consecrate, to set apart. Thank you, Sister Vivian, to lay out to observe the Sabbath day. There are lots of implications in this. Sabbath also is inspired to rest from labor, to set apart the time to communion with God and others. And holy means something is sacred and dedicated to God. So we set apart this Sabbath day for God as our expression of love and allegiance to God. So as followers of Jesus Christ, we celebrate Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and worship on this seventh day of week, because Jesus died on a cross on Friday, and Jesus was resurrected 3 days later on Easter Sunday morning. So according to Adam Hamilton, he says, for Jews, the Sabbath is Friday night to Saturday sunset, representing the seventh of the week. set apart by God in the Ten Commandments as a day of rest and worship. This particular day is tied to the seventh day of creations, the day on which God himself was said to have rested. In Deuteronomy, the seventh day is tied to the Israelites' exodus from Egypt. Meanwhile, most Christians observe the Sabbath on Sunday, as this was the day when Christ was raised from the dead. So early Christians called it the Lord's Day. That's why Sister Vivian says, this is the day that the Lord has made for us. As each Sunday was time to proclaim and celebrate a new Christ's resurrection, the day on which Christ conquered evil and hate and sin and death. So we proclaimed, this is the day that the Lord has made for us, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. And some Christians observe the Sabbath on Saturday. You see the differences between the Jewish tradition and Christian tradition. We Christians totally rely on Jesus' resurrections on Easter Sunday. That's why we celebrate on Sunday. So how do we make the Lord's Day to be holy? Well, it begins with the Ten Commandments. Do you memorize and teach your children with the Ten Commandments? Do you? Anybody remember what are the Ten Commandments? What is the first commandment? I can see the murmuring, whispering, okay. But Ten Commandments, first one is, you shall have no other gods before me. Then what is that means, you shall have no other gods before me? Matthew? What does it mean, you shall have no other gods before me? It's okay. Well, let me tell you. What is the second commandment? Okay. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything, and shall not bow down to them and worship them. And the third commandment is, you shall not make wrongful use of the name of God. And first commandment is remembering the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Basically, God is calling people to keep the main thing, love for and allegiance to God above all else. And the fifth and tenth commandments is to love others as ourselves. So how do we keep the main thing and the main thing? When the teachers of the law asked Jesus, saying in Matthew chapter 22 and 36, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus says in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And this is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbors as yourself. So all the law and the prophet hand on these two commandments. Basically, Jesus sums up the whole Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, with this greatest commandment. What is it? Loving God with all your heart, mind, and souls, and loving your neighbors as yourselves. So you can memorize the Bible with these two greatest commandments. It can summarize the whole Bible. The one of the best way to keep the Sabbath day holy is dedicate our time and energy and everything to worshiping God. We set apart our time to praise and honor God. It is our main priority as followers of Jesus Christ. So therefore, to keep the Sabbath day holy means is to offer ourselves to God with our whole being and share God's love with others. You can forget every other commandment, but remember these two greatest commandments. This is our principle to connect the source of our everything and blessings for the sake of our well-being. This is about the covenant relationship between God and humanity, and this is a holy relationship. But what if we don't keep this covenant relationship? What if we break up these relationships? How does God feel about it? In John chapter 2, it says Jesus expressed how he was feeling when we break this holy and loving relationship with our greed and desires. In our human flesh, human body, we often chase selfish desires rather than seeking heavenly things if we don't connect with God in the spirit and truth. And we are easily prone to follow wrongful things, misuse God's name in vain, and Satan always devours if we don't connect God. In John chapter 4, verse 24, it says, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. But in New Testament, today's reading, when I read John chapter 2, I wondered why Jesus was so upset and indignant. In Jesus' context, people came to Jerusalem to worship in order to celebrate Passover festival from all over the place. They came speaking different languages and carrying foreign monies. This Passover festival was huge for celebration of God's grace upon their lives. And they wanted to dedicate the best gift to God on these days. Enterprising merchants had set up booths and stalls in the temple to help the travelers coming to worship who needed to exchange their monies in order to pay taxes and make their contributions. Because at that time, Jesus was not died yet, so they still do the burnt offering, and they had to buy the animals. And people were busy selling animals to be used in the sacrifices. Of course, there was a great, great excitement. The temple was a sacred place for Hebrew people. The tabernacle, you remember when they were in the wilderness, in the desert? The traveling temple of tent was the center of their Hebrew community that symbolized the presence of the Holy God. In this long history of the temple, Jesus was very angry when he found the people were busy selling animals, exchanging monies. And Jesus drove all of them out of the temple with a whip of cords and poured out on the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. Jesus was so angry, but Jesus was almost always kind, loving, gracious, we remember. This is the first time we see why Jesus was so angry. Because it matters, Jesus, what happens at the temple if we don't teach the truth, people can be led them astray. Jesus was upset because there was a deep fake false information. Nowadays, we are dealing with the AI technology and deceiving the people like a Taylor Swift, deep fake informations. Even political agendas, President Trump, former President Trump, using this AI technology, leading the people into astray, into the false informations. It is a matter of how we can keep Sabbath to be holy in the eyes of God. When we help others in the name of Jesus Christ, we must ask ourselves why we are doing this. Last week, I shared with you what are the differences between Mormonism versus Christianity. They're all talking about the Jesus Christ. It seems like we cannot distinguish if we don't connect with God and study the Bible. You know, as I explained to you, Mormonism starting in 1830 by Joseph Smith in America, in Vermont. They practice polygamy, many wives. They speaking about Jesus, but they deny the deity of Jesus. They don't believe the Trinity. They don't honor traditions. There are so many differences we don't recognize. We are easily can be guided into false informations. So what is the purpose of the doing things? Without worshiping those, our helping, we cannot glorify God, because our good works cannot save us. Some people say they believe that they can be saved by their good works. Like Mormonism, they teaching that if you do good jobs, you can be saved without going through the Jesus Christ. That's very dangerous. It's almost Christian, but not true Christian, according to our belief. We often help others to glorify ourselves rather than God. While we helping others to make ourselves feel good out of a charity mindset, or for the sake of God's mission, out of loving God with our whole being and others as ourselves. It depends on our heart conditions, whether we present ourselves as a living sacrifice to God or not. Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, therefore, brothers and sisters, in the view of the mercy of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, and present and pleasing to God. This is your true worship. So the people ask Jesus, let me go back to the text. What sign can you show us for doing this? Basically, they ask, what authority do you have for doing this? Why were you so upset? Why you turned the table upside down? Then Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will rise up. Do you know what that means? They responded, the temple has been under construction for 46 years, and we raise it in 3 days? Are you sure? The people were puzzled. The disciples were confused. They didn't understand. How can you build this temple? How can you destroy this temple and build in 3 days? Can you do that? What does that mean? Well, Jesus refers to the temple as the body of Christ. It's not about the building. Jesus died for our sin and rose again 3 days later for the sake of our own salvations. When we share the gospel of Jesus Christ, there is God's presence. The church is the body of Christ. The church is people. It was true that the people did destroy Christ's body, but Jesus was resurrected in 3 days, and we are now part of the dead body. You are the church, we are the church, we are the body of Christ. So Apostle Paul says, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, don't you know that you are God's temple and God's Spirit lives in you? We are raised up with Christ by God's grace. Worship is about resurrections. Worship is about our expression of love, our love and gratitude to God. We are the temple of God when we glorify God through our words and deeds. We are being raised up as we gather in communion together. So dear siblings in Jesus Christ, worship is very important. Personal worship is very important, but the communal worship is very important because we are the body of Christ. We live in a world that can easily destroy the body and the souls if we don't pay attention to our Savior and the Lord and Jesus Christ. What elevates us and makes us joyful and happy, it begins with right worship. This is our principal quality of living. And otherwise, we always chase wrong things that consumes us. It begins to dedicate our time and life energy and resources to God so that we can be raised up like Christ. Therefore, may you be blessed in the name of the Creator and Redeemer and Sustainer. As you follow Jesus' teaching and keeps the Sabbath to be holy with your presence, prayer and gifts and witness and service. This is the true quality of living. This is our principle that I bless you. Amen. Amen. Communion servers, please come forward. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who honestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us confess, merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were as sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us recite the Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died, was buried, and he descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. In love, you made us for yourself, and when we were fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, your love remained steadfast.
You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that renewed by your word and sacraments, and fervent prayer and works of justice and mercy, we may come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who you love. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to redeem the world. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in our likeness. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. He took upon himself our sin and death and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sins of the whole world.
By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offerings for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on earth and gathered here, and on this gift of the bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory as we feast at his heavenly banquet, through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many, we are one body, For we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is sharing the body of Christ. The cup which we're sharing is the blood of Jesus Christ. We as United Methodist Church, we don't discriminate anyone. This is the means of grace that when you receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ, you can encounter the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Whether you get baptism or not, Christ invites all God's people into Christ's table to receive God's grace. So please come just as you are and remember that God loves you. God's grace is available to you always. Receive it as a sincere, faithful heart, so that you can truly experience God's presence and God's grace. Amen. And please, the communion servers, and please guide them with two lines while I'm giving the bread and wine to the communion servers. And then we can hand out to you as we receive it together. And we can receive it at one time. As I said, this is the body of Christ. It's broken for you. And also, well, juice is the same thing. This is the blood of Jesus Christ is shed for you. We can drink it at one time.
Jesus, I surrender, Lord, I give my
God loves you. Let the church say, Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ is shed for you because God loves you. Let the church say, Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
As we continue in praise and worship on this third Sunday in Lent, let's stand all over the church and sing, Just As I Am, without one plea. The scripture declares, He cried out, Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink.
Just as I am without one plea, but death thy blood was shed for me, and death thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
Offering times, and we invite our young adult to do special songs. So Juan and Rodrigo and John will do the special songs for us. And while we are doing it, we will offer our gifts and tithes to our God. May God bless you as you go out, tell the people that God loves them.
Because it's been Amen, amen, amen. What a blessing we have our young adult praise band. Thank you, John and Juan and Rodrigo. Let us pray. Mighty God, we give you thanks. We worship you with songs and psalms and hymns and special songs. Especially our young adults, they come to you and to praise you. Mighty God, as they bring their gifts and talent to worship you, bless them beyond their imaginations. Rekindle the heart of your love and patience so that everybody can see your light through them. We are so grateful to have you and have them to praise you. And we offer our tithes and offerings for your glories. Use it for your ministry, for your kingdoms, so that many people come to you and receive your grace and your healing and salvation in Jesus Christ. Let the church say, amen. 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 This is a mission and ministry moment, and Sister Josie, but it's late, so we can do after worship service. Sister Elaine?
As we take our worship, praise, and prayer from this place and into our daily lives, let's stand and sing like never before, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." This song is an expression of unwavering faith, hope and comfort found through trusting in Jesus as we go through life's challenges and adversities.
It's so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him and his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know the saints, the Lord. Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, precious Jesus, trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, how I trust. Him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
No, our oxen here receive the blessings and benedictions. We sang, Jesus is mine. We sang, blessed is assurance. This is my song and this is my story. So now go out, tell the people, the grace of God be with you. God always loves you. So share the good news with others. Make sure keep the Sabbath day, the Lord's day, to be holy through your presence. And in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, be with you and forever and ever. Let the church says, amen, amen.
Spirit speaks to me with my